Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the new episode of The Future Hour. This is episode number 11, and the guest today is Allison Duettmann. Allison is the president of Foresight Institute, a nonprofit to advance biotech, nanotech, computing for the long-term benefit of life. She shares Foresight's work with the public, for example, at the Wall Street Journal, South by Southwest, O'Reilly AI, World Economic Forum, the Partnership on AI, Effective Altruism Global, TEDx, and so on. She founded existentialhope.com, co-edited the book Superintelligence, Coordination, and Strategy, and is currently working on a book on intelligent cooperation. She holds an MS in philosophy and public policy from the London School of Economics, focusing on AI safety, and a Bachelor of Arts in Philosophy, Politics, Economics from York University. And this episode is extremely important and super, super excited for me personally, because Allison is someone that I personally extremely admire. And maybe because of that, during a podcast, I was a little bit nervous and mispronounced a few things. So forgive me on that. Stay with us. This episode is absolutely amazing. Make sure you subscribe and follow her work at Foresight Institute as well. And on top of that, this episode is only the first episode of a mini series that I'm doing, The Future Hour is doing together with Allison from Foresight Institute. So please enjoy. The Future Hour is now. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for tuning in. This is another episode of The Future Hour. Today, I'm so thrilled and so happy to finally have Allison Duettmann from the Foresight Institute to be on the guest. And she's absolutely amazing. Not only she's extremely smart and intelligent, but also she is so have a big heart, because even she forgive me, agreed to do this amazing interview with me. Even sometimes, maybe I might mispronounce her last name. So, thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you very much for having me.
Yes. So we're about to cut right into the exciting part, which is, Allison, would you tell us a little bit about what is your superpower? What is your special sauce in your organization?
Superpower, I think now I can only disappoint. I don't necessarily think that, that it really is one, but I think that a conceptual framework that I found really useful for dealing with situations where I haven't really felt at my best is to consider the other counterfactual. So, I was always really unliking of the fact that we will eventually have to die. And I think that, getting really hung up about that can be really depressing at times. And so I think considering the counterfactual that death is only so bad because life is so good has tremendously helped me. And I think, that's in my own, more personal self-interest. But the same is true, I think, for if we consider existential risk and if we consider the risks that we're also worried about, right? Those risks are really only so bad because the upshot, the opposite side, so the counterfactual of like what would happen if we don't wipe ourselves out is so good. So I think that, keeping in mind that oftentimes your fears are only so prevalent because the opposite end would be so good is a really good action motivator, because then you can focus on the good part. And by that, I think you're more likely to bring those about.
That is very interesting, and I can definitely relate. Something Steve Jobs has mentioned before in his 2005 Stanford graduation speech, I believe, that he said he constantly look at himself in the mirror and ask himself, if today is my last day on this earth, would I still do the same thing that I will be doing today, right? And he said that in front of death, that everybody is already naked. And that is quite important and very, very helpful for me too, right? So follow-up question with that, what is your viewpoint on death? And when you think about death as a topic, how and what do you think about it?
Well, that's a good question. I think, it kind of really relates to how, for me, it is not just a topic. It is, I think, almost the fundamental driver of many of the things that I do in my own life. Like, I think my dislike for death really has been, I guess, one of the most poignant moments in my life. And one of the first memories that I really have was really just being terrified of the fact that it will be over one day, because every single bit in life is really just so good, right? And so it's, I think it's always been a driving motivator for me to do something about it. But, you know, at the beginning, really, like, if you're like, I grew up in Hamburg in Germany, and it's not particularly the place where people are used to the idea that you can do something about it. So I think that, you know, from my really personal thoughts, first, I thought it's just the thing that we have to face. And I was totally confused by how not everyone is incredibly upset at this point and is trying to do something against it. Then I kind of got socialized into the idea that there's just nothing to be done for a long time. And then I, you know, kind of like did a little stint in philosophy to try to come to terms with the fact, okay, what do you do if, you know, if there really is a finite life? Like, how do you create meaning in this finite life? I got into existentialism mostly. But then luckily I discovered transhumanism, and that mostly as a philosophy first, but through that much more, you know, philosophy of science and also the idea that actually something could be done about aging. So I kind of switched my mind frame from, okay, instead of trying to create meaning within the finite boundaries, why don't we try to push those pretty arbitrary finite boundaries a little further out? And so that's, I guess, how I got to do the work that I currently do. But, you know, I think that ultimately your worry about your own death, or maybe it's not the same for everyone, I can only speak for myself, but yes, for myself, it became kind of clear that my worry about my own death is really like a puberty version of a much bigger fear. And that's of, you know, life as a project in itself coming to a halt, right? But I think when you're a child, you can't really conceptualize that civilization isn't stable, right? You think that maybe the only thing that you have to do is to hang on yourself. But then over time, as you grow up, you also get kind of like slowly the thought trickles in that maybe civilization as a whole doesn't survive. And so I think that, you know, your own appetite for living a longer life is almost like, you know, a puberty version, or is subsumed in the larger set of wanting life as a project in itself to flourish and to continue. And I think, you know, that second realization that that may not be a given is also, I think, a pretty formative moment in your life. And so I think it's, you know, my focus on, you know, longevity in my professional life and also existential risk at the same time, I think are deeply interrelated, because one really doesn't make very much sense without the other. Yeah.
Yes, that is such a beautiful answer. And I definitely want to ask a few questions to dig into
some of the thoughts you had ever since your childhood. But before that, would you mind in one or two sentences
tell us a little bit about what problem you and Foresight Institute are solving and why?
So I guess Foresight has been founded for like 35 years ago now. So it's been around longer than I have been. And even like all the way back then, people had this really optimistic vision of a long-term future. And if I go back into our archives, it's just astonishing the ambition and like tenacity that people had and the just the futures that they were able to imagine with a much lower level of technology and scientific progress available at the time is so inspiring to me. And so it was founded on this vision that, you know, really good futures are possible if we, you know, push for the upsides and avoid the downsides. So it had this really, you know, I think for me, really optimistic vision in the future of the future. And it's basically since then, really since for all these years, has been plowing away at the problem. It is focused on a few specific technology areas, which is biotechnology, mostly for health extension, so to significantly extend and improve human lives on molecular machines, or like the problem of trying to really get to atomically precise control of matter, because that would give us a real head start into solving most of the other problems that we worried about. And then finally, really trying to create cooperative architectures in which humans and AIs can ultimately cooperate best. So it's always been focused on the intersection of different technologies. And I think that's what makes Foresight really special. So currently, this is kind of translated into three different groups that we have in these areas. And so the idea is that we currently in the world lack a little bit the capacity for taking on really ambitious long-term challenges, but the people are already there. And so it's about a way of bringing them together and enabling them in a framework to do really, really impactful work. And so we have three interest groups, and those interest groups are scientists, entrepreneurs, and institutional allies, and they cooperate really in a really tight setting for advancing those goals of escape velocity and longevity, atomically precise control of matter, and private secure cooperation across humans and artificial intelligences. And I think what's to me really special about the Foresight community is that A, they've been around for a really long time. So we have people that, you know, have been working at this problem, as I said, you know, for like now 35 years. A few of them have now Nobel prizes. Many of them have our Feynman prizes. And they are now being integrated with the next generation of people working on exciting technologies. And to me, that intergenerationality is like something that's really, really, really exciting, because we always lack, I think, you know, as the kind of like new generation, the new kids on the block, we often lack the historical perspective of like things that have been tried before, you know, of just like a little bit of context. And meanwhile, you also have that idea that science advances one funeral at a time. So you need new talent in those areas. And so having this historic continuity is, I think, totally exciting for me with Foresight. Then the second thing about Foresight, which I already touched on, that's really exciting to me is the interdisciplinarity, right? Like it really rests on the assumption that technologies don't get developed in a vacuum, but they probably the most exciting advances in 10 years will be at the intersection of current disciplines. And so that's why we have really a tight-knit collaboration also across our biotech and nanotech groups, for example. And then, you know, really finally, I do think that we have to also get around to the fact that collaboration needs to be much more international. And I think for that, COVID was a blessing in disguise, because, you know, it allowed us, for the groups at least, to create a continuous virtual layer by which those groups can now exist and cooperate on a regular basis. And so we usually meet biweekly online now in these groups and have a really tight high trust cooperative layer by which people can get together on a regular basis and really spur progress in their areas.
Wow, that sounds absolutely incredible. From the history of the Foresight Institute and the whole various different layers of the things you are doing, like with this the different groups and also the weekly meet. So, question, for example, maybe you're mentioning there are entrepreneurs, there are scientists, and there are industry experts in different groups. For example, if someone wants to join the group, what would they need to do or be? Do they have to be like super, super expert in the industry to be, or you know, or maybe for example, someone like me that know nothing about nanotech, but I'm super interested.
Different layers of, I guess, of engaging with a group. The first base layer is really just, we have all of our videos up on YouTube. So we try to, we really try to make everything public. There's a few off the record discussions because a few of the things are not published yet and so forth. And there's a little bit of private cooperation in the group, because I think sometimes that's needed to then have a common narrative, you know, that actually helps to advance the field. But, you know, the main level of entry is just like go on YouTube, type in Foresight Institute, and then you have the different groups appearing there. And then if you want to dip your toes in further, you can apply to join the group. So on our website, on each of the different programs, there's an application form by which you can apply. And then finally, for those people that, you know, are trying to make the science happen and have the finances to do so, you can donate to become a part of the group. And this donation really goes to the fellows that we support in the group and to the projects that are being developed inside of the group and to the in-person meetings that we're slowly but surely getting back to now. So there's those three ways, I guess, to engage with the group and all are cut out for really trying to push the field along as much as possible.
Absolutely. So when it comes to application, like what are the criteria for... you know, for you're looking at to take somebody into the group, just really quick,
I think that for what Foresight is really good at is trying to look in the areas that are maybe even too fringe for standard organizations to consider. And so if you're working on something that you think will be extremely revolutionary, but that may, that you don't really have the cohort yet for others to really conceive of this, then maybe Foresight could be a good container for you, because people are really ambitious in our groups. And we are able, because we're so small and pretty nimble, to take on things that may only pan out in the next 5 to 10 years, and where there's even not really a very high interest at the moment. And with 5 to 10 years, I mean, like, there needs to be something there in this timeline. Many of the technologies take much, much longer to actually come to their full fruition. But I think, you know, if you're that kind of person that is like pretty ambitious and you're still searching for the cohort, and you're like, why is no one really, really taking this on yet? This would definitely be a game changer in the next 5 to 10 years, even if it is, or especially so, if it is bridging to disciplines, then, you know, we may be the right cohort for you. We are trying to actively pull people from academia into action. And this can be either starting a company, or it can be starting a different type of organization that may not be on the current menu yet. And so we have in our computer science group, we are currently experimenting with different structures that people can cooperate through to push for technological progress. So if you think you have an idea that you think can make an impact, but you don't even really know if it's made for the private sector yet, we may even have a vehicle for that. So yeah, be ambitious, like high risk, high reward projects. I do want to say, even though we focus on health extension, atomically precise control of matter, and computer science for intelligent cooperation, we also have a very, very soft spot for space and for neurotech. So, you know, they are somewhat inside of those silos already. But if that's a problem that you're working on and you're looking at your cohort, then we may also be the right organization for you.
Okay, awesome. So then we'll have to do a call to action here. Everybody, you all should definitely go subscribe Foresight Institute on YouTube. Make sure to turn on the notifications and go check out their website as well. There are a bunch of amazing content, and Allison and her team, everyone within the organization. Indeed, I was checking the YouTube channel earlier today. Many, many super interesting videos, and they talk about it in a way that is explained in a way that's very detailed. And even for somebody like me, I'm definitely not an expert in everything you mentioned. But I still find it interesting. I can still engage with the conversation you are having. So I think that is great. And so shout out to you and shout out to the Institute. You know, great job, everybody. Along the line, what is the connection between existentialhope.com and Foresight Institute?
Well, existentialhope.com and Foresight Institute are, I think, to me, Existential Hope is kind of the guiding star of the work that Foresight Institute is working on. So to provide a little bit more context on this, Existential Hope is a term that is not coined by me, but by Future of Humanity Institute. And there's a fantastic paper out there on existential risk and existential hope, in which they really describe this term. And it is built on the definition of a eucatastrophe. So if a catastrophe afterwards, you have much less expected value than before. With a eucatastrophe, it's the opposite. And so this is an event after which there's much more expected value, potential value for the universe out there after the event than before. So it's this kind of like, again, mind shift of like not looking at the negative, but looking at a deeply positive event or at a deeply positive outlook on the long-term future. Upon reading this paper, which really, really just stood with me, I became inspired and created a website called existentialhope.com, on which I currently log with the help of volunteers, just readings and documents out there that convey a really positive approach to the long-term future. And this is basically based on my boredom with all the negative science fiction that's out there, and like this disillusionment with which, you know, people in the next generation really just grow up and are deeply enculturated by the time that they hit my age. I think it was already the fact when I grew up that people were pretty pessimistic and really for like no reason whatsoever. Yes, we have a ton of problems. I'm not, you know, trying to be naive about it. But on the other hand, I think it's like it's we are already at a point at which we can complain and improve on the bits that are not working well, rather than, you know, like we already have the mental space to even conceive about those changes. And I think all the progress that is often made is often forgotten because it's so subtle. But our world and data actually does an amazing job at tracking the progress that we're making. And so I think, you know, it would be almost a shame if we didn't, if we couldn't accept the progress that we have been making and the amazing futures that are available to us. And so in order to just, you know, pick people up and say, hey, look, you know, it's not perfect yet, but it's already much better than it has been before. And there's a lot of work to be done, but there's also amazing futures to be had. I created this website on which, you know, I just try to collect the most positive sci-fi, but also technical pieces out there to create like an onboarding document for the next generation, for if people are kind of vaguely looking into the future, but don't really know where to look and what to do, they can go on that website, hopefully get inspired, and then can self-select into different topic areas that they want to focus on. So I link to a lot of organizations in the futurist spaces. And yeah, just trying to provide a little bit more of a positive narrative about the future, and then a few action guided links from there. So if you're vaguely looking for orientation, maybe that's a good first step to start. If you're looking to contribute, there's a form out there in which you can do so.
Fantastic. I'm definitely going to link the website and everything we mentioned here during the conversation at the show notes. And the website you created is very interesting to me because, and it's important, I believe, because there's this hub, this website people can simply go to and they can just explore on their own to get an idea. Or they could get super in-depth into it to really dig into what you're talking about and to see, you know, all the readings. And I assume that people are also having discussions on the website as well, right?
The discussions are happening mostly, I guess, you know, behind the scenes. We used to have, in San Francisco at least, you know, amazing just... Yeah, amazing salons where people would get together and just share what really inspires them about the future. And then we would just update the website. We have a group within Foresight as well called the Existential Hope Group. And that is, you know, really trying to corral people that are interested in positive long-term futures to make sense of them and kind of chart potential positive futures out there. And so for me, you know, the Existential Hope layer is really trying to provide the narrative and the guiding stars for the technologies that we're working on. Because I think that oftentimes those people working on tech, they know, of course, they know why they're working on it, right? But I think oftentimes that gets lost to the public. And I think that actually technology is one of the most important things to be moving along. And I think that, you know, connecting the two dots and just, you know, showing why technological progress is so important and why it's so inspiring, where we could go if we do it well, is, I think, something that often gets kind of like lost in translation between the two. So we're hoping to connect, you know, more great storytellers and more the people that really inspire folks of why we're building those technologies with those that are building the technologies. And so, yeah, if you're interested in that kind of work, then maybe the Existential Hope Group that we have at Foresight is for you.
And everybody who are interested in what we're talking about right now, you can stop this podcast right now and go check out those websites, and definitely strongly encourage you all to do that. So then I am guessing that you create the existentialhope.com first, and then somehow you join the Foresight Institute, right? Because this is where, okay, cool. And then
the other way around, actually. So
tell us about how did you join the Foresight Institute, right? Because the last time we were having the conversation, you were saying that, oh, my journey, you know, you were mentioning to me that, oh, my journey is definitely not like a straight line. It was, you know, it's a beautiful journey, right? That's what I'm super interested in. Okay, where did Allison came from? You know, why she is so interested and so brilliant with all these various super cutting edge technologies, and why you're so, how come you're so passionate about, how did you even like pull this off? It's just absolutely fascinating for me.
Well, it was lots of luck, I think, but, you know, to me, I mean, I guess I already touched on this a little bit, but, you know, I really came from a drive or like a real longing for there to be more, and like a longer life for myself, for my family, for everyone I love, and much more longer fulfilling lives for humanity. And there was not really ever a space to talk about that, right? People usually are so wound up in their own personal lives, and it wasn't really a thing that you could really just discuss, like a longing for more. And then I found Foresight. Well, basically, through this longing, I went into philosophy because I just wanted to figure out, like, okay, what is there? Like, why are we, I think, just scratching the surface on our everyday lives about, like, what's humanly possible for ourselves and for civilization at large? And then through that, through philosophy, that was what my, academic career was focused on. And then through philosophy, I discovered Foresight and this incredibly positive, optimistic approach to the future. Got very, very inspired, went into our archives, into all of the, I think we had one of the first websites out there, really. The sheer ambition with which people here tackle problems was super inspiring to me. So then I wrote them a cold email and promptly got invited to San Francisco. And so I moved, kind of like gung-ho to San Francisco. And then I just clung on and stayed with the organization, became from a volunteer to a researcher to a program manager. And now I'm president, or have been since a year now. Yeah. So it's wow. been kind of unusual. And, you know, I really think that, I'm pretty grateful that they took a chance on me, because it definitely changed my life from black and white to color.
Why is that? Why they took a chance with you and they changed your life from black and white to color?
Well, just because they give you permission to not be apologetic about wanting more for humanity, yeah. for life, and showing you ways that you can get that. You know, rather than kind of minimizing your expectations of what life could be, you're trying to maximize your ways of kind of lifting up the current status quo to meet your expectations. And I think that's definitely a thing that is done within Foresight. It is continuously pushing you. But it's also something to be done, I think, that you have just naturally in the Bay Area, that you have in very little other places in the world, where in Germany, people always ask you, why you? If you tell them about an idea that you have, they ask you, why you? Why now? You know, why this? And here, the first question that people ask, oh, why not? How can I help? Like, it's a very, very different culture layer. Yes. And it's really inspiring.
Absolutely. So I came from a psychology, business and psychology background, and I have this hypothesis that our motivation so much is based upon the programming or the experiences or the events we encounter when we're kids. So you mentioned quite a few times that you wonder why not more, why not make things better? And were there a specific event that happened to you when you're a kid that made you always searching for more, always, you know, pushing this boundary, always raising the bar? You know, would you, if you had that, would you mind talking specifically about that event? Because
I guess maybe two come to mind. One Amazing. Was, there was a time when I thought that I could read all the books. So I was really into books, and I made a list. And I thought, okay, well, I'm just going to plow through them now, and then eventually I'll be done. And then obviously, the more you read, the more you read about the books that you haven't read. And then also, meanwhile, the more books get written. So it is
absolutely
never ending
yes.
never going to be able to read them all. And then through that, I realized, wait, it's not only books, but there's that similar trajectory in every single thing that's exciting about life, right? I'm sure that if you picked any other potential, let's not call it a hobby, interest, then the more you know, the more there is to know. And I think until we know that there is an end to that, so until we know that, you know, like returns are increasing, the more we know about this thing, there is really just no reason to not want to live much longer. And it's the same for civilization at large. Again, you know, like we're just starting to wake up as a civilization. We're just starting to figure out how things work. We're just starting to like dip our toes into space. Like there's just so much out there, and it would be just so incredibly premature if this all went to nil now. So I think that realization of just like, oh no, I'm not making progress on the books that I want to read just because there's so much more amazing stuff that's out there. The more I know about it and the more gets created every second I live was to me very, very formative. I think then on the other end, my daughter...
Really quick, how old were you at the time when you were starting putting together this long list?
I don't know. I think I...
Roughly?
Very young. I mean, I don't know. Pretty young. I would have to lie. I'd have to lie if I could tell you exactly no, but when. But it was one of the earlier moments that I can remember. Really, I guess since I started reading, really, you know, and then once you start reading, you make a list and you kind of become hooked. Yeah.
Yes,
so early, but I honestly, I would have to lie if I gave you an exact time now.
Yes. Maybe you can take some time to think about it. Maybe in the second episode, you can tell us, you know, this is, you know, this is a hook for the next episode. Okay. And please continue.
Well, the second one isn't very positive, unfortunately. It is when I think I must have just, I don't know, I think I was around 18 years old when my dog died. And I really loved this dog a lot. And
what was the name of, what was his or her name?
Lucky. Yeah.
Lucky.
And it was so formative because I thought I could maybe just call Alcor, like the Quaronics organization here in the US, and have my dog be vitrified, right? Until I figured out, no, this is not how it works. You need to do this earlier, right? Like the Alco does pets, they do cryonically preserve pets, but you need to get your act together and sign up before and so forth. It's not like you can just, I guess I thought, you know, somehow that there was already a way in which people, you know, in Silicon Valley have maybe figured it out a little bit and were maybe already starting to make progress. And I thought we were just a little further along in this than I knew, because I'd read about cryonics before. And I was like, okay, well, I guess it just maybe works. And maybe at least there's like some kind of life-saving vest by which we could at least preserve a small chance at death not being the end of it. And then I realized, no, there's actually we're not that far along as we think we are, and still not. And so this kind of realization that if you don't get your act together, and if you don't do it for yourself, and if you don't sign up to things, if you don't try to push the limits, then no one's going to do it for you, and then it may be too late. So those two realizations of like, A, so much more is possible, and then B, but if you don't go out and get it, no one's going to do it for you, and it may not at all get done, are, I think, pretty formative childhood memories or youth memories.
Yes, it's my heart's go out with you and with Lucky, and and there's also something I believe in, is that every event and circumstances unfolding in our life exactly as it should, because they are opportunity for us to be on our path to be the true version of ourselves, so that we can give our gift to the world, right? So so with the example of Lucky, was that moment give you this idea that you also mentioned about in the previous interviews that you had? This idea that what happened if one day people came up to you and tell you that if you really go for it and you could have make all the difference about the change that you wish to see in the world. What was it? That was a moment you start having this idea, or?
Yeah, I guess it's like a general policy of minimizing regret. So sometimes, you know, I guess, and it ties back to what we talked about with the counterfactuals before, right? Oftentimes I think, you know, when I see lots of really brilliant people who are like, well, I don't really know if I should try to make a difference about long-termist goals, or if I should try to pursue this really ambitious technological goal, because what if I don't succeed and then I will have wasted my life away? And then I always think, okay, well, now think about the opposite, the counterfactual of that. It's like, what if you didn't do it, and then you realize at the end of your life that if you had only pursued this one thing, there would have been a significant chance that you could have made the difference to get that thing off the ground. That would have been a much worse future, right? So even if the chances are small, I think you want to live in the world where you will have given it your all, just to minimize the regret of having not done so, because the upside risk of leaning in is so big. I mean, what's available in the, like, what's, for all we know, what's potentially available in space and in long-term human futures and in long-term human AI and potentially other mind cooperating futures is so vast that not leaning in is so short-sighted. At least, I'm not saying everyone should go for it, but if you make this calculation of like, okay, I can either be at the end of my life and I will have not leaned in, and actually if I figure out that I could have made a difference, I'll still be fine with living the life as I do, then don't do it. You know, like, it's really just, it's a decision that everyone has to make for themselves, right? Some people are generally much, much happier if they just, you know, focus on their family, their friends. I think we often forget just how incredibly important community is. We always think it's just about ideas, but actually, no, it's about the people around you really that help you. And so, you know, if you make that, you know, if you rationally consider this, your two options, and you come out with the fact that, no, actually, for you, it's more advantageous to just live your life to the fullest now, then I totally support you. And not everyone has to go out there and get it all. But I think if you already have a little bit of a glimmer of hope that this is something that, you know, you could be doing with your life, then I think really just making that, considering the fact that if you haven't done so and you know you could have made a difference, if that is would be upsetting to you, then you may already be at the cusp of wanting to tip in. And then I would say, check out Foresight, check out Existential Hope, and check out many of the other amazing futurist organizations that are out there.
Absolutely. Question. Are there other life science and biotech companies that you found interesting? They could be private or public ones, and briefly tell us about what they do and what problems they are tackling.
Oh man, there are so many. I can't tell you how excited I am every day that I lead our biotech and health extension group, because we have an interview about 3 to 4 people sometimes per day that are interested in joining these groups, and many of them are so brilliant. So like, I don't, it's really hard for me to pick any winners, because there's just so much, like, so much amazing, amazing, amazing development out there right now that I'm like, absolutely, I'm just really grateful to be alive right now. Very exciting times. We in our biotech group, we have a fellowship for each of the groups. So this is, I guess, absolutely, another plug. If you work in either biotech, in nanotech, or in computer science, cryptography, and machine learning, then consider applying to our fellowship for next year, in which we try to help particular individuals that have really, really ambitious long-term future goals and that are working in those areas with a mentorship program. So if that's you, then please apply. But in the biotech group right now, we have a fellowship and we have an accelerator program. And so we're really trying to focus on advancing a few projects out there that are tremendously, I think, inspiring. And there's two in particular that we have already accepted, or at least one is already public. The other one will be probably by the time that this gets released. But one is Jean Aubert's a project on brain cell replacement. So he's at the Albert Einstein School of Medicine. And his idea really is that, okay, look, you know, we really have already been able to really replace every part of the body except for the brain. If we want to make long-term progress on aging, the brain will become more and more important. So we need to figure out a way to replace gradually the brain. And so he's working on approaches for doing so. It's a really ambitious effort. And I encourage you to check out his work. So it's Jean Hubert at the Albert Einstein School of Medicine. And he's also on our Foresight YouTube channel. So that's one. The second one is Shift Bioscience, which we'll be presenting tomorrow. So by the time that this is probably out, presented. And so they are based on the premise that there's really a race to deliver rejuvenation drugs. And they are really working on identifying safer drug targets for cellular rejuvenation. And they're doing that by applying machine learning, driver clocks to cellular reprogramming. So they really, I think, are now at the cusp of really validating a few drug targets that can allow us to really rejuvenate much, much safer. So I think, you know, those two are really two fantastic projects. There's probably going to be a third one that I can't mention yet. But those are a few areas. I'm personally still really interested in cryonics. I think this is kind of on the cusp of being still too niche and weird for many organizations to take it on. But I do think that this is what we still need to figure out and where a lot of progress is needed and possible.
Why is too niche?
Well, I think that, well, I don't know.
Because it's super important. It's super important, right?
I think that it shouldn't be niche. So I can't really give you a really good reason why it is. Maybe they had bad PR before. Maybe it is just something that the more people tip into it, then, you know, the faster you know, the avalanche will grow of people tipping into it.
Yes.
I mean, look, even talking about the fact that I want escape velocity and longevity for most people alive today, if they want it, was a crazy thing to say, you know, five years ago. But now, since COVID, progress has been accelerating so fast in biotech that now you can say that escape velocity and longevity is a thing that you want. So I'm thinking that in 5 years, people can just openly come out of the closet and say, yes, I'm signed up to cryonics. and yes, you know, chances are not great right now that that will make it through. But I mean, the only way that you can increase your chances is if you work at it and if you throw money at the problem and if you throw fantastic research and talent at the problem. And you only do that if you tip in. So it's a chicken and egg problem. And I think we kind of owe it ourselves a little bit to suspend belief and to just do the things that are necessary to get things off the hook, even if most of society isn't ready for them yet. And again, you know, I want to say that this is, I personally want this. It doesn't mean that you have to want this. If you don't want this, this is totally fine. I'm not trying to impose anything on society. Foresight certainly isn't.
Absolutely.
It is just for those people that for whom it's already exciting. I want to encourage you guys to stand up for that and to give yourself permission to find it exciting, even if most others don't. So this is not me trying to overlay a certain framework of thought on everyone at all. I think that everyone knows best what's good for them.
I think you are just being unapologetic about who you are and about what you're passionate about. And like you're just taking action and along the side talking about it, right? So I think that's extremely important. Especially in this nowadays that there's so much information out there on the internet, right? So there is there's so much information, then certain kind of ideas and information needs to be constantly being repeated, being put out there. And I think your role as the president of Foresight Institute and your energy in front of the camera during the interview is absolutely fantastic and it's being appreciated more and more so each day by the society and by the public. So, you know, that's amazing.
Well, thanks. I do think that, you know, we know so little. I certainly know so little. I think that we as a civilization know so little. So, you know, I've probably been wrong 10 times just in the time that we're talking, right? And so I want to preface everything with just saying, you know, I don't have a technical scientific background. And I think that most of the things that, you know, we are currently working on will probably be obsolete in 5 to 10 years, but they only become obsolete because people keep on pushing, and because people keep on making progress. So I just want to encourage those that are out there and interested in that to do so. And if you think I'm wrong, then prove me wrong. I would really welcome that.
Yes, absolutely. And it's so important about just making the progress, right? Encouraging more people to, especially, and this, the purpose for the podcast is to spread ideas for a brighter future so that more and more smart people, and especially younger generation, are just being inspired. They think that, oh, what they're talking about is actually cool, is actually sexier than I expected. And maybe in, you know, now they're in elementary school or high school or in college, maybe they're going to be looking into more into it, read a book about it, or maybe, you know, take a classes about it. So, Yeah,
I mean, I have to say, look, it's really about all about the next generation. Like, I thoroughly believe this because I think our generation can maybe still muddle through. But I think if COVID has made one thing really clear, then it's that our opportunities and our downside risk have just gone through the roof. I think it really just tremendously accelerated the kind of, you know, the impasse at which we're standing, because on the one hand, biotech has sped up in an incredible way, right? We can now do things that we couldn't do before, and that's due to COVID. Software has accelerated, right? Crypto has accelerated in an incredible way, very much because of COVID or because of the collateral effects of COVID. On the other hand, we also, man, it was a pandemic. It is a pandemic. And so you also see that many of the structures that we thought were much more functioning, or at least resilient, then are actually much less so than we thought they are. So, you know, we really have this like terrifying look into the abyss of like how quickly everything could go away. And we also, on the other hand, have this opportunity of just like, oh, but we could also accelerate so fast if we have to. So we, like, I think the opportunity costs are just getting much more prevalent now. And I think the next generation really is, are the ones that will have to carry the torch, because we were still able to muddle through, but I think things have just picked up in speed a lot in the past few years. And so it's really all on you guys, if you're listening to this, and if you want to contribute to the effort, then, you know, there's lots of amazing future-facing organizations to do so. Foresight's not the only one. It's definitely one of them. But, you know, there's Future of Humanity Institute in Oxford. There's Future of Life Institute. There's like a variety of just really fantastic organizations out there that are making incredible progress. So please just, you know, self-select into the bucket that you think you can do so best. But it's on you. If you don't do it, no one will.
Yes, absolutely. I think it's super important about each individual to really rise up and realizing their own power, realize that they can be the change, or at least they can be part of the change. I think that's extremely important, and for myself and for you, and especially for the future generation. So earlier you just mentioned crypto. So do you have a comment on the future trajectory of blockchain technology and industry?
Oh man, now I'm quoting myself here. I guess without wanting to go into any bits and details that may be totally irrelevant in the next, you know, a hype cycle. But I think there's two things that I feel confident in saying that are probably undervalued and underappreciated still in that space, but definitely in society at large, is one is the intersection between blockchain or crypto commerce, as we call it, and AI. And so that is AI, like, I mean, I think it was Peter Thiel who said that, or Reid Hoffman, of like, you know, crypto is inherently libertarian and AI is inherently centralist. I think if you want to, you know, that's obviously like, you know, it's a meme to say something else, which is, you know, crypto is really, really good, or like crypto commerce, right? Decentralized architectures are really good at incentivizing local knowledge to be brought to bear. And AI is really good at just, you know, taking a lot of data and making really amazing, but, you know, so pretty, like, I think general, like, extrapolations from that. And so I think the intersection of the two will be really interesting. Also, I think from an AI safety perspective, because by building decentralized structures, we can maybe counter some of the kind of runaway singleton dynamics that we see in AI systems. At least that's my hope. And this is the basis for a book that I'm currently collaborating on. So I already mentioned the computer science group that is focused on a human and AI cooperation via crypto commerce. And that whole group is based on a book that Mark Miller, Christine Peterson, and I are working on. The book is called Intelligent Voluntary Cooperation, and it is trying to create systems which in which humans and AI can voluntarily cooperate on the long run. So that's one aspect, is the intersection, I think, between AI and crypto commerce. And then also in the book, and also I think undervalued, is the other topic, and it obviously relates, which is privacy. And so I think it is one of the things that I think we will only know how important it was when it's gone. And we are standing to lose it at the moment, but we're not quite there yet. And I think it's tremendously underappreciated how important it is. Privacy is important. Like, you cannot be your own person if you don't have the privacy of your own mind to form your own thoughts. And I think that much of what we see right now of the confusion is because people don't really have the space to form their own opinions. And so it's tremendously important, I think, and it's all going away. Like, with, I think without having the ability at least to transact privately, and with everything being available on a public blockchain, you then on the long run have, you know, really the threat of machine learning techniques getting much, much better at doing traffic analysis and of actually, you know, just really tracing back your blockchain interactions to your physical addresses and of you being physically coercible. So if we want to avoid those dystopian futures, and we're already racing towards them, then we need to get our act together with privacy now. And yeah, so that's number two.
That is just absolutely fantastic and mind-blowing. And I'm super, super interested.
And terrifying.
I know. And maybe I think we just found our topic right now for the second episode, like literally. So that's beautiful. And I do know that you also co-edited the book Superintelligence, Coordination and Strategy, right? Would you mind tell us just something super, super quick about that?
Sure. I mean, there's the fantastic book Superintelligence written by Nick Bostrom. This one is more about trying to bring different actors together that are working on human AI cooperation. So basically, Foresight has been doing private meetings of different people working on AI and AI safety for a long, long time. For a long, long time, that would be a lie. I'm for, 5 years. But they have definitely been coordinating people for much longer than that. But for 5 years, we've been doing so in those, smaller once a year meetings. One of them kind of like sparked interest by Roman Yampolsky, who's a fantastic computer security researcher. He was asked to basically do a book about this topic of just, coordination and of strategies to get us to superintelligence. Because even if we figure out the technology, it's not really said that we will be able to figure out a safe way to develop it. So I think actually the human cooperation that happens before that is really, really important. And the way in which those technologies get developed is really important. And so that book is solicited contributions from a few really fantastic authors that contributed chapters to it. So rather than me having done any work that is even just worthy of mentioning on this, it was mostly us compiling the work of others. So the chapter contributions are by really fantastic people that, you should follow up with more. David Mannheim, for example, wrote a fantastic chapter. He's one of our Foresight fellows now. And Kristen Carlson wrote one on distributed ledger for AI safety. That's another great one, who's also in the Foresight ecosystem. And so, yeah, I encourage you to check out their work much more than it's more a compilation of fantastic work than me having done any work with this.
Absolutely. And two things, a plug, shameless for myself, please, in the short future, put me in touch with all these people you mentioned. I'm literally going to do like at least one episode with every single person you mentioned. So that's number one. And number two is that tell us about where can we get this book, Superintelligence, Coordination and Strategy.
You can Google it. I think there's even a free online version thereof. I definitely linked to it from existentialhope.com. But yeah, it should be available. You can also buy it and if you prefer the paper version. I think that's more expensive because it's, it's a pretty like still high, like it is, it doesn't require any technical knowledge per se, but it's definitely, I think, it's definitely for, I think, an audience that likes to think deeply. So it's not necessarily introductory text, but I think that everyone of your audience can probably grok it.
Yes. Maybe my audience, they are, if you're listening to this right now, maybe you are up for a challenge. So go check it out, go find out, and go buy from online and show some support to the lovely people working on amazing things. So let's turn the topic and question to a little bit different vibe, which I will guess that maybe you don't get to answer these kind of questions that much, which I'm extremely excited about. Would you mind tell us about what role does love and affection play in your life?
Yeah, I really don't get that very often at all. This is definitely, well, I mean, it's kind of interesting. It's, it is, I mean, okay, so Existential Hope, right? Most of the work that the website is about and certainly my initial appeal to that was intellectual. But look, it's, like all of the kind of like positive visions for the long-term future, they deeply rest on a feeling of love and affection for life and for humanity, right? So I think that, you know, sometimes we get caught up in all of the idea space and just like, you know, those are the particular rational reasons why we should be doing those things. But sometimes it's really just a feeling that is much more inspirational and a better action motivator than just particular scientific ideas. And so sometimes for some people, you know, it's really love and affection for life, really, and like a deep love for humanity that I think actually rocks the boat sometimes underneath, you know, but we verbalize it often in I think more theoretical constructs. So it's definitely an underlayer that I think is an incredible motivating force, I think, for much of the things that we do. And I think I already touched on this, right? But I think that actually the people in our lives are incredibly important, right? Without the ecosystem around you, you cannot be doing most of the things that you dream up in your head. So I think, you know, just love and affection, having love and affection in your life is an incredible action motivator. Meanwhile, at the same time, it's also a distractor. So one thing that I struggle with personally is kind of delayed gratification. If you think we could be living a much longer life, you personally, but civilization at large, then maybe the way that you show love and affection for those around you and for life at large is sometimes compromising on it on the short run. Because by doing your work, you know, work is, I mean, there's never a time when you couldn't be doing more. Right. And so sometimes I think that, you know, love and affection can not really be a distraction, but I certainly struggle with it, you know, on a personal basis. Like, let's just be honest, of, you know, the time that you spend working, kind of pursuing the longer term love and affection that I think you have for humanity, and then on your own personal life, trying to make room for it and trying to make room for the people that are so important in your life and with whom, without whom you'd be nothing. And so it's a dichotomy, and it's a difficult rope to walk on, and I can't say I'm an expert on it.
That is absolutely fascinating. And there is, this might be something that you and audience find interesting. I find this some connectedness between the spiritual world and like those people who are really super dedicated on building something that's great, right? Because, for example, Buddha, that when he was dedicated to become who he was, the Buddha, he had a wife and kids, and he literally just left the palace and he just went out to meditate and he just let go and drop all the attachments, right? And people who believe in and are actually dedicated themselves to build a brighter future. And I think there must be decent amount of sacrifice as well, right? So just a follow-up question to dive a little bit deeper into that. Because I imagine you work tremendous hours, and from what you're saying, I assume that you have a romantic partner as well. So how do you personally balance that?
Not very well. Not very well. I think probably sleeping less than I should. But
do you two have argue or quote unquote fight over work?
No,
something like that.
Yes, with or love and affection. I mean, to me, I really mean all of my community. So I live with fantastic people in my life. I live in a community house, and oh, wow. I, one of the people that I work with at Foresight, Lou, is also happens to be really one of my best friends. And so to me, like, this love and affection piece is, you know, broader than romance in itself, right? It is really Absolutely. Just the people that you're with and that you're around. And, you know, I have the fortune of having a fantastic chosen family here in San Francisco. I very, very much miss my family at home, and I see them often. But here it is this incredible community that I currently actually am in, of people that care deeply about the long-term future, and that collaborate a lot on making it happen. So my bridge of saying, or my bridge to how do you square the two, is try to find people with which you can do both. Try to find people with which you don't have to choose between your intellectual and life's passions and between affection. I like to do it all together. I think that, you know, if you have a community with that you, that deeply cares and loves while also having really ambitious goals, you don't have to decide one way or the other. Like, living here is so tremendously inspiring. It's hard to put into words. And here you don't have to make the sacrifice very often. Most of our dinner conversations are about the long-term goals. We help each other in incredible ways. And, you know, much of my professional work fuses into my private world here. Many of our Foresight salons are hosted in San Francisco at the embassy. Like, that's the community that I live in. And vice versa. Like, many of the people that live here speak at our salons often because many of them work in space and so forth. So I think, you know, if there's one advice, then, you know, try to look for people with who you don't have to compromise.
Absolutely, absolutely. And this is super important for me personally, and I believe for the audience as well, right? Because the younger generation, they are constantly looking for a role model to learn how they do things. And for example, let's say if someone grew up watching so much Hollywood movies and romantic drama, maybe he or she growing up only thinking about, oh, if I want to be happy, I want to be fulfilled, I must find a boyfriend, girlfriend, like, and be together with them for a long time, right? And what you just said is very interesting, because you are giving this perspective in a way that is, when you are truly living in an environment that there is love and affection, not only in your personal life, but also in your work life, and fuse those two together, you're just giving myself and other people, and especially younger generation, a totally different perspective. So, which I appreciate that very much.
Thanks.
Let's wrap it up this episode of podcast with an advice that you would give it to a younger version of yourself.
I guess this ties into actually what I just talked about. It's like, it sounds so banal, but like, trust yourself and don't get distracted. You know, like, I think that holding on to those more long-term visions when I was really young was really hard, because it was so fringe. And I was really the only one, like, that really believed in this, I guess, to some extent. And, you know, that really thought that, like, a long-term future is something desirable, is something possible for myself or for others. And I think if you were in that situation, it's sometimes really easy to just kind of get numbed by society, right? And to, like, lower your expectations and to just say, well, maybe it's just some kind of, like, you know, a little cray cray thought that I have. But I think just actually sticking to it and just trying to not let go. Like, sometimes, like, on the one hand, we learn a lot, right? As we grow older, we become much more experienced and to some extent also conservative in what we think is achievable. And that's good to some extent, because we have the experience to make it through. But on the other hand, sometimes society, like, you know, numbs you, and it kind of like
absolutely
it pushes you down and it makes you not dream big enough. And so you unlearn a lot of things, like a lot of the questions that kids ask for good reasons, they are not answerable by adults, because adults have tricked themselves out of thinking that they're important, or have just been socialized into into not thinking about them anymore. And I think that, you know, keeping that childlike curiosity and wonder, and not letting it get kind of like burned out by society and by all the naysayers and by all of the short-sighted pessimism out there, like keeping that flame alive until you hit a community of people that you can just enlighten the fire with, I think is really important.
Wow, that's absolutely fantastic. And what you just said just now made me thinking about two sentences or two things about Picasso. Picasso, he said this one quote saying that every children are geniuses until they grow up and become adults. And another thing is that at the end of Picasso's life or his painting career, and one day he went to this children's painting exhibition, and he went there with his friend, and those children painters are from like 10 to 15 years old, and he was walking and see all the paintings, and he said this to his friend. He said, when I was at their age, I could paint like Raphael, which is the Italian Renaissance painter. And then he stopped and he said, but it took me a whole lifetime to be able to paint like them. And so that is just exactly what you're saying about unlearning so many essentially bullshit in our mind, and truly to grow up and learn the skills and experience that we need to learn, but also keep that fire, keep that passion within ourselves. And I genuinely believe that when you are really keeping that passion, you are also becoming a magnet, that you are naturally just drawing more people who are equally passionate about potentially the same thing into your life. And I can definitely speak about that from my personal experience. So
I think it was Socrates or Aristotle, I would have to butcher it now, but I think it was one of them, and I can look this up, but who said youth should belong to the elders, in the sense that you only realize how incredibly amazing and impactful you were growing up, and all of the incredible just wonder that was in your life back then, when you're old and you have kind of forgotten about it and you're not really able to live that life anymore. So, you know, I encourage everyone who's young out there to just hold on to this and just, you know, live it to the fullest. Don't be naive about things, right? Learn and work within the limits, but also always keep on pushing the limits. There's no time that's too early to start. The task is really big, but you have amazing people around you. Like, I'm pretty, pretty hopeful and optimistic about the future if I look upon the amazing people that are helping to create it already.
Amazing. Well, there's nothing more I could add on for this episode. You know, thank you so much, Allison, for your time. And let's definitely do at least one more episode, maybe two more, maybe more. And just want to say thank you so much for your time. And I can't wait for the next episode. Yeah.
Maybe the same with books, or what I said earlier about books, is that the more episodes we do, the more episodes we will have to do, because there's more
yes,
to talk about.
Yes, absolutely. And actually, I have a question when you mentioned earlier. So roughly how many books you read per year? Roughly. Or how many books you read a month? Then
as I would like anymore, because I'm writing my own at the moment. Hard to say. I do this cheating thing where I listen to most of them, and I listen to most of them on double speed, and I skip around. So I usually listen to the first part, then to the last part. So it's a very weird way of doing it. And then I listen to bits in between. So okay. I don't really do it the correct way, I guess, of reading a book. But I get the beginning, the ending, and I get the layering and the style and the gist
absolutely.
Of it.
Okay, cool. Well, then, you know, maybe take some time to, you know, like to go through your list and then let me know next time how many books you read per year. I'm just curious. So there's like benchmark for, you know, for the ambitious younger generation, be like, I'm wondering if I could, you know, match the amount of books she reads, and one day I'm gonna be as smart as my as impactful as she is. So another question, just curiosity, how many people you live with currently? And yeah,
15. I also want to say it's not only books that make you smart, it's a lot of prototyping and experimenting. So, you know, like there's opportunity cost to everything. It's not that you can read your way into a perfect knowledge. You have to eventually just go out and try things, you know? So do that too, you know, and a lot of it. Yes. You know, don't get caught up only in theory land. Like there's incredible experiential knowledge to be had from just doing things. And that's certainly one thing that you learn, I think, in the Bay Area. And yeah, I live with 15 people.
Okay, awesome. Well, the next episode, the first question is going to be, Allison, tell us something. Allison, give us tips about going out there and experimenting, you know, along not only on the side of like reading a ton of books. So yes, again, you know, thank you so much. I'm so grateful, and keep up the great work, and we'll reach out.
Keep up the great work. Thank you very much for having me on. This is really, okay. I'm certainly leaving into the day much more hopeful than
awesome. Awesome. Yes. And we have this like a business global community, right? So we're just playing our part. And yeah, and I'll actually be back in California probably next month. And yeah, when I'm out there, I'm probably going to be in LA. I'm going to go up north and pay you a visit, or you let me know when you're in LA. And also just sidebar really quick, you know, cause I host a lot of events as well, with my media company. Foresight Institute should definitely have like meetup, like San Fran, LA, New York, well, all those cities, or maybe you all already have that. Because
we're currently building out a global layer of that. Yeah, we have them in San Francisco, and we're starting in Europe. We have, for example, our annual member gathering will be in San Francisco in the Bay Area on December 4 and 5. And it will also be at the same time in Chateau du Fay, like a castle in France. So we have an online and in two locations, and they will be collaborating with each other. So it's going to be quite the wild one.
Wow, so, yeah. Amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing. Yep. Either San Francisco or friends, I'm going to be there myself, and probably going to bring all my friends there as well, if that's possible. And yes, well, thank you so much, Allison. Enjoy your beautiful day, and talk to you very, very soon. Okay?
You too. Bye-bye.
Amazing. And could you mind tell me how to pronounce your last name, please? Really quick.
Good luck. I'm not very hung up about it, but it's Duettmann. Maybe it's the same then with books. In the sense that...
Awesome. Yeah.